Hallelujah. Let's give it up for Jesus. Amen. Amen. If you can please grab your Bibles right now, but we may be seated right now in the house of God.
Yes.
And we're going to start today on Deuteronomy. Let me get this. Hold on. Deuteronomy 28:1-4. If I can get an amen when we get there. Amen. We're just going to get started right now, but just as we get started today, you know, I have the honor to do the blessing blockers, and Brother Martin, he's going to go ahead and do the blessing builders. All week, we've been studying about having the blessing blockers and the blessing builders. So today, if we read off of Deuteronomy 28:1-14, it says, the Word of God says, if you fully obey the Lord your God carefully, follow all his commands I give you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all nations on earth. All these blessings will come on you and accompany you if you obey the Lord your God. You will be blessed in the city and blessed in the country. The fruit of your womb will be blessed, and the crops of your land and the young of your livestock, the cows, the calves of your herds, and the lambs of your flocks. Your basket and your kneading trough will be blessed. You will be blessed when you come in and blessed when you go out. The Lord will grant that the enemies who rise up against you will be defeated before you. They will come at you from the directions, but flee from you in seven. The Lord will send a blessing on your barns and on everything you put your hands to. The Lord your God will bless you in the land he is giving you. The Lord will establish you as holy people, as he promised you on oath. If you keep the commands of the Lord your God and walk in obedience to him, then all the people on earth will see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they will fear you. The Lord will grant you abundant prosperity in the fruit of your womb, the young of your livestock, and the crops of your ground. In the land he swore to your ancestors to give you, the Lord will open the heavens, the storehouse of his bounty, to send rain on your land in the season and to bless all the work of your hands. You will lend to many nations but will borrow from none. The Lord will make you the head and not the tail. If you pay attention to the commands of the Lord your God that I give you this day and carefully follow them, you will always be the top, never at the bottom. Do not turn aside from any of these commands I give you today, to the right or to the left, following other gods and serving them. And then right here, verse 15. However, if you do not obey the Lord your God and do not carefully follow all these commands and decrees I am giving you today, all these curses will come on you and overtake you. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, right now, Father God, we just ask right now, Lord, that you cleanse our minds, Father God, cleanse our hearts, Lord. Let us receive your word for tonight, Lord. Right now, Lord, as we're all here gathered tonight, Lord, we give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. And in Jesus' name, the church says, amen. And tonight, we're going to concentrate on verse 15 because I'm doing the blessing blockers. But it says, however, if you do not obey the Lord your God and do not carefully follow all his commands and decrees I am giving you today, all these curses will come and you will come on you and overtake you. Amen. And one of the blessing blockers that I have tonight that I'm going to be doing is the curses of disobedience. Amen. Amen. And disobedience is one of the blessing blockers that when God wants to bless you, that if we have disobedience to his word and to all his promises that we're not doing, we're going to block the blessing that God wants to give us. Amen? You see, disobedience, I have the definition as to neglect or refusal to obey, the omission of that which is commanded to be done. And that's not self-will, only God's will. Amen? Non-compliances. Amen? You see, in Romans 5, 12 through 14, it talks about through by one man's disobedience, many were sinners. And that's speaking of Adam. Amen? And you know, through that disobedience, you know, disobedience was not, you know, following God's word. Amen? Disobedience is caused by rebellion or distrust of God. Amen? You see, the word of God is what we live by. Amen? When we came first to Christ Jesus, and when he died on that cross and we accepted him, you know, it's God's word that gives us life. Amen? But a lot of us tend not to follow God's word. Amen? You know, we want to do things still on our own that we haven't fully trusted God. Amen? So, now, to be disobedient is to yield to self-will instead of surrendering to God's desiring his will in all things that we do. Amen? So, when we are disobedient, we neglect the word of God, and when we also will refuse the word of God to obey it. Amen? You see, in 1 Samuel 15, 22 to 23, it talks about, but Samuel replied, what is more pleasing to the Lord, your burnt offering and sacrifice, or your obedience to his voice? Listen, obedience is better than sacrifice, and submission is better than offering the fat rams. Rebellion is as sinful as witchcraft, and stubbornness as bad as worshiping idols. So because you have rejected the commands of the Lord, he has rejected you as king. You see, if we start to look at our lives, you know, in disobedience, it's not good. You see, God wants to bless us, but he can't bless us if we're not right with him. Amen? You know, in verse 15 in Deuteronomy, it talks about curses of disobedience. And one of the things that when I was studying the word of God, you know, it was just teaching me a little bit more of understanding that, you know, as a father, as we have our fleshly father, if we're disobedient, you know, we get punished. And that's one of the things that I noticed that a lot of the times when we don't follow the word of God, we're going to end up getting punished. So we put these things upon ourselves. Amen? But also, it was talking about God won't keep us in that place. You know, a lot of the times we ask ourselves, why are we going through the same thing over and over? Why have I been here for 5 years and still in the same chair, same spot, no growth or nothing? Why am I getting blessed? Well, a lot of the times we have to take a look and examine ourselves and see, are we being obedient to the word of God? Amen? Also, it blocks a lot of the blessing, but I have one that to become disobedient, again, it's rebel against God. But disobedience also allows Satan a legal claim to what God wanted to bless you with. This is because you are submitting to the kingdom of darkness and not to the kingdom of God. Amen? So that's one of the things that we don't want to submit ourselves in disobedience to the not hearing the voice of God. Because if we're being in obedience to the voice of God, then we're following to the things that we have to do as Christianity, what we have to do for God. Amen? To move into the things of God. If we're being disobedient, then we're probably listening to the other voice. Amen? And we have to understand that that's going to block our blessings. Well, if somebody tells me, hey, Brother Mondo, I'm always disobedient, but I still get blessed. Then we really have to really examine ourselves to see who's blessing us. Amen? Because the enemy can bless as well. You know, so if that's where we think our blessing, we're getting blessed. No, you know, let's get back into the things of God. Amen? Well, that's my first blessing blocker. The next one I have is lust. Amen? What are we lusting for? Well, the definition that I got for lust means a strong craving or desire to the flesh. Amen? It can be, you know, from whatever it can be. It can be sexual immorality, you know, things pornographic. But it doesn't just stop there. There's even more to it. Sometimes lust can be food, or the root of all evil, even money. You see, when we put our desire into lust, if it's money, let me kind of read this right here. Where was I at? Hold on. Okay. Okay, where am I at? Sorry about that, guys. You see, in Proverbs 27:20, it talks about Sheol, meaning hell, and Abaddon, meaning death, are never satisfied, nor are the lustful eyes of men. Lust empties a man's peace, love, and truth. Amen? Lust can also mean money to you or the things of this world. The Bible has a lot to say about lust. But the Bible further defines lust as the root of all evil. Lust puts material things above God. And a lot of the times, that's where we have to be careful. Is our money being funny towards not doing the things of God? Are things more above God, you know, more important? You see, when I started, like, seeing these things that I was tripping out, you know, in the world, how celebrities and all that, man, they just give their lives up to, not to God, but to money. And when we start to understand that lust, you know, if it's money, it's taking us out, you know, to give our heart's desires, and it's not of God, then it's in the wrong thing that we have, because it shouldn't be like that. If we're going to lust for positive things of the world, well, I'll leave that for my brother when he comes, because I'm kind of trying to do the blessing blockers right now. But it's not things that we're supposed to lust for. So it's not money. It's not women. It's not men. It's, you know, food. And anything that is above God. Okay? Let me... Okay. Let's see. You see, lust is defined as the love of the unrighteous. Lust is selfish and uncontrolled desires. In Colossians 3:5, it says, "Mortify, therefore, your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, martinate, affection, evil passions, and greed. For greed is a form of adultery." You see, so we got to get that out of our mind if it is money. Amen? And then in 1 Timothy 6:10 says, the lust of money is the root of all evil. People lust over money because it can buy their heart's desires. A lot of the times we got to look at it, and it's true. You know, either if it's whatever it's taking us, but it's putting for our desires, for our own selfish needs. Amen? You know, so one of the things is we have to get rid of lust, because it will block the blessing that God wants to bless us. Amen? Now, my last blessing blocker that I got is no seed sown. And if we can turn to Galatians 6, chapter 6, 7 through 9. If I can get an amen when we get there.
Amen.
On Galatians 6, 7 through 9, the word of God says, "Do not deceive yourself. No one makes a fool of God. You will reap exactly what you plant. If you plant in the fields of your natural desires, from it you will gather the harvest of death. If you plant in the fields of the Spirit, from the Spirit you will gather the harvest of eternal life. So let us not become tired of doing good, for if we do not give up, the time will come when we will reap the harvest. Amen. And that's one of the things that we have to understand. Where are we sowing our seed? A lot of the times, as Pastor has been preaching to us, you know, we'll end up receiving, you know, the seed, but we won't plant it. And if we can't plant it, then God can't, you know, bless us with it. Amen? Because it talks about in the Word of God that it's going to be a blessing to make a harvest. But if we ain't planting seed, it's not going to happen. And also, we got to understand what kind of seed are we planting if we are planting seed. Are we being positive into the things that we're doing, you know, sharing, being Christ-like on what we're doing to make that harvest grow? Or are we just keeping it to ourselves or for our own selfish things that are being planted out there? So as a blessing blocker, if we're not planting the right seed, like we were doing the ministry classes of growth, you know, it talks about the seeds that are planted by the waters that, man, just are flowing, you know. Is there fruit bearing from that tree? Or is it just the seed that is just dried up and it's just drying up, you know? So one of the things that I say I would want is just remember this. That if we're not sowing right seed, it's going to block our blessing that God wants to put in us. But with that, I got. Thank you, guys.
Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, give Jesus a big hand. Praise report, my wife gave birth to twins. I feel like a changed man.
You are.
Pastor even told me you're more compassionate, you know. I said, thank you, Jesus. That's what I was praying for. Oh, you guys ready? Amen. Mondo talked about the blessing blockers, and now we're gonna build our blessing now, because whatever the enemy intends for evil, God will turn it around and work it for good.
Right.
And we're on the topic of blessed to be a blessing this month. And man, how many of you guys know that we've been hearing some good stuff?
Amen.
We've been hearing some good stuff. If you will take heed, amen, if you take heed to the Word of God, believe me, and you work the Word of God in your life, you will see increase. You will see, you will bear fruit. You will be a changed person. You will progress and advance and grow in your calling.
Yeah.
And in Matthew 7:24, the Bible says, therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine, this is Jesus speaking. He says, therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. Father, I thank you for your word. Moved by your Spirit, Jesus. God, we need you in this place tonight. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
See, there's purpose behind building. And we need to understand that there's purpose behind everything that God wants to do in our lives. There's always purpose. There's purpose why you're here tonight. There's purpose why you're hearing this word tonight. There's purpose why God has surrounded you with awesome people. And there's purpose why you do what you do for God. And so God wants us to build our blessings. And so there's purpose behind that. And we must build if we want increase.
Right.
We must build. You got to build. You got to put some work into it.
Yeah.
You know, it takes work. I talk to people all the time. And, they, you know, they're right there. We're all in it together. And they share with me, well, this is happening. I'm not seeing no increase. Well, what are you doing? Are you investing yourself in the things of God? Are you seeking God for yourself? It's a personal relationship. This is not religion.
Amen.
Come on. You know, religion, you know, it's just a front. Jesus said, it's dead men's bones. It's a form of godliness, but no power. I want the power of God. I want to know Jesus. I want to experience the presence of God for myself. I want to know God is my provider. I want to know God is my healer. I want to know God is my redeemer. I want to know God is everything that His Word says. But it's only when I'm willing to take that step of faith and do what I'm called to do. And so there's purpose. Number one, and we spoke on disobedience. Mano, hit on it. But if we want to build our blessing, we must build our obedience. Mm-hmm. We need to build our obedience. Obedience, check this out, it's a lifelong practice. You can't be Mr. Super Obedient overnight. There's no such thing. I mean, even the Pope has problems with being obedient. Come on. You know, your flesh and blood, you're going to have a little bit of flesh trying to rebel against the purposes of God. You know, and so obedience is a lifelong practice. It's a practice. But it's essential. It is essential. It's vital. It's crucial. It's needed for our relationship with God. And obedience is the key to God's blessing. You want God's blessing on your life? It's not going to come by being disobedient. It's going to come by being obedient. But you have to have an encounter with Jesus. You have to encounter Him in His love and His mercy, and He will prompt you to be obedient. Yeah. People have a problem with being disobedient because they're not yielding to the Spirit of God. You can be obedient. And so obedience is the key to the blessing. People who don't obey often live a life of bondage because they choose death and cursing over life and blessing.
Yeah.
When we're not obedient, and I know Mondo spoke on all the negative things of being disobedient, you know, but I got a little more. but when we're not willing to be obedient, then we choose life and death and cursing. Yep. And you wonder why you're in bondage all the time. Yeah. See, when a person, check this out, I got this from a commentary, and it's got to be good if I got it from a commentary. I usually don't, you know, quote commentaries. But when a person is truly born again, he has the Spirit of God living within. And the Spirit enables him to know and do the Father's will. God's love in his heart motivates him to obey God and serve others.
Yeah.
You need the Spirit of God. You know, that's the evidence right there. That's the evidence right there. It's the Spirit of God that prompts you to be obedient.
Yeah.
When Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, it was the Spirit. He was God. He was 100% God and 100% man, but He felt the weight of what man feels. And when He felt that weight, you know, the Bible says He said He asked God, and He said, God, let this cup pass from me. But nevertheless, God, let Your will be done. Jesus was obedient to the will of the Father. And so how do we know if we're obedient? Because, you know, there are some traits of obedience. You know, of course, we're obedient to the Holy Spirit. You know, whenever you feel that tug in your heart and you go against it, that's being disobedient. But when you feel led of the Spirit, oh, man, to change, I need to change, then you're being obedient to God. And you're willing to take the steps, no matter how bad it hurts. I'm willing to quit this. I'm willing to let go of that because I want to be obedient to God. Mm-hmm. But also, a way we can tell if we're obedient is we obey God's leadership. Because God has leadership on earth.
Yes.
And we need to be obedient to God's leadership. God, that's how God establishes His authority. Is through the leadership that He's placed on earth. And God has authority on earth through His leadership. People who say they obey God but don't submit to God's authority are liars. They're liars. And so what we might say, well, we can't be obedient. Well, we need to... You know, this is the bottom line. We need to repent of our rebellion. Because we all have rebellion. We all struggle with rebellion in our flesh. We need to turn away from that and be filled with the Spirit of God. And because only the Holy Ghost can prompt you to be obedient and submissive. It's only the Holy Ghost that can prompt you and move you in the direction of being obedient and submissive to God's authority. The bottom line is this, church. That if we obey God, we build our blessing, leaving an inheritance for our offspring, because it's not just about you. Just like Abraham. God told him, because you obeyed me, you obeyed my voice, I'm going to bless you. God told him that. I'm going to bless you, and I'm going to bless your, those that come after you. And when you obey God, not only do you receive a blessing from God, but you leave an inheritance for your kids. You leave an inheritance. You know, the reason why there's such an anointing on this platform is because our pastors have labored and obeyed God. And that inheritance, it's not because you're such a good preacher. You know? It's not because, you know, no, man. It's, you're sitting, if you're behind this pulpit, you're sitting under the anointing of the pastor that has labored and been obedient to the will of God. And because of that, there's an inheritance. And we're sitting under it. And we're inheriting it. You know, and so that's the bottom line. You will inherit a blessing for your offspring, your sons and your daughters. You want to know why, man, there's a lot of times that people wonder why, oh, man, what are they going to change? Well, what are you doing about it? What are you doing about it? Are you sowing? Are you being obedient on your own and to God and being submissive to Him? Because believe me, that's building up treasures in heaven, and God will release. He will release as you continue to press. Number two, we must build our self-control. Mano spoke on lust. Not just the lust, you know, that men carry towards women. Hello, somebody. But we want to talk about the lust, the general lust of the world. Lusting over the world. Lusting over worldly things, worldly possessions, lusting over money, lusting over a position, lusting over a status, lusting over, you know, things that aren't gonna, they're not gonna help you in building the kingdom of God. See, we need to build on self-control. God, the Bible says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of self-control. Or a sound mind, or self-discipline. That's the Holy Spirit. He gives us self-control if we're willing to yield to Him. If we're willing to yield to the process, it's not going to be easy. But it is possible. It is possible. And we must build on it. We need to build on it. We need to exercise self-control. Not just, okay, once a week I will work on self-control, but then the rest of the week I'll just live like hell. No, it's a constant work. It's a constant work in my life. It's a constant work. I got to check myself every day, man. Because when I wake up, Count Chacho wants to come up and he wants to take over. You know? Flesh Gordon, whatever you want to call him. You know, building on self-control takes discipline. It takes discipline. It takes discipline. Good to see my dad. My dad's here today. Amen. My dad taught me discipline. He taught me discipline. And I used that in the things of God. I used it for checking myself. And man, I want to walk blameless before God. And it takes discipline.
Yeah.
It takes discipline to walk blameless before God. Because I have a flesh just like everybody else. My flesh wants to get high. My flesh wants to party. My flesh wants to do what it wants to do. But if I allow it, it's only going to breed corruption.
Yeah.
See, building on self-control takes discipline. To most, living a self-disciplined life is a life of hardship and endurance. Right? It's hardship and endurance when you're disciplining yourself. You know? It takes endurance. It's a hardship. It's a trial sometimes to live a life of self-control. But you've been given the power through the Holy Spirit to live a life of self-control. You've been given the power, love, and of self-control. And so we need to understand that. See, giving in to lust is the easy way out. Anybody can do it. Anybody can take the easy way out. I always like to say it's not easy. It's not easy living for God. But nothing good comes easy. Nothing good. I'm talking about the good that comes from God. Nothing good comes easy. It takes work.
Yeah.
See, giving in to lust is the easy way out. And it will not only affect us, but it also will in the long run, it'll affect our sons and daughters. And we've seen that in the life of King David, how lust for women, lust for things, got the best of him. And at times it ultimately was passed down to his sons. See the lust for things, lust for this world, lust for, lust that burns inside of you, it will be passed down to your kids. Don't be selfish and think that it won't, because it will. It will be passed down to your kids. It will be passed down to those after you. And we got to be aware of that. Sometimes we think, I'm not affecting nobody by the way I'm living. No, you're wrong. If you're living like hell, you're affecting those that come after you.
Yeah.
You're affecting everybody. Don't be selfish and think that's not true. It is true.
Yeah.
When you live a certain lifestyle, it affects everybody. Your kids and everybody around you. And you wonder why they grow up the way they grow up. It's because you left that legacy for them. And so ultimately, it will be passed down. And so it's important to build a life of self-control during the lifelong process of transformation, because we're all under construction. Mm-hmm. No one here is perfect. We're all under construction. And it's a lifelong process, this transformation. So see, if we allow our flesh to have control, then we will only breed corruption. The Bible says, for he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit, here's what I want to get to, self-control, he who sows to the Spirit will reap of the Spirit everlasting life. Self-control produces life.
Right.
It produces life for yourself and those around you. See, number three, I want to talk about sowing. Mano spoke of not sowing any seed. Well, we need to understand that we must build on our sowing. And the Bible teaches the principle of sowing. You read your word, you're going to see. You reap what you sow. You will reap what you sow. If you sow nothing but stuff that just breeds corruption, then you're going to reap corruption. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap everlasting life. The Bible teaches that. There are many areas in which we sow seed, but if we were to combine them all, they would fit into two categories. Check this out. I summed it all up into two categories, the two things that we sow in. And one is our time, and the other is our finances.
Amen.
Right?
Yes.
Our time and our finances. The time you sow in prayer, the word, and in serving others is important. The time you spend with your family at home, and the time you invest in ministry, it is in its proper balance, is also very important. This all pertains to sowing seed. You're sowing seed when you invest time. Our finances are seeds that can be sown as well. If God has blessed you with finances, then your priority should be to fund what God is doing in your local church.
Yeah.
If God, if you're blessed, you need to believe God to an extent where you know what your money. You put your money where your mouth is, And if you're believing and trusting God, then you know what? This money, God, as a matter of fact, God allowed me to breathe this day so that I can have this money. So I'm gonna use it for His glory. I'm gonna invest it in His things. I'm gonna use it to advance the kingdom of God. See, Galatians 6:9 says, let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. See, time and finances are two areas that show where our lives are invested.
Yep.
Time and your finances will show where your life is invested.
Amen.
Because the time that you have on earth and the resources you acquire are investments, and the type of return you receive is determined on where you invest. I want to ask you tonight, where do you invest? The first one is our time. Where does your time go? I want to ask you tonight. Where does all your time go? This is one of them. But, there is such a thing as working a little too much. There is such a thing as being a workaholic and spending all your time. I mean, I know people that they just work and work and work, and they come and sleep, and then they're just back at work, and they neglect their families. And their families end up hating them. There is such a thing as working too much. I choose to trust God. I choose to trust God with all my heart. Work doesn't have me, You know, and so another one is unproductive habits. You know, don't watch a little too much TV there. Where's all your time go? I'm talking about. Another one is wrong with the wrong people. There is such a thing as people that are sent by the enemy to suck you and consume you of your time.
Yeah.
Come on, I've experienced it, man. Sometimes, you know what? They don't want to get it. They don't want to come to church. They just, you know, they don't want to hear it. They just want to suck up my time. And I got other people to reach. I got other people to invest into. And there is such a thing as investing your time into the wrong people.
That's
you know?
Right.
See, we must prioritize. Our time must belong to God's will.
Yeah.
Our time needs to belong to God's will. You claim to be a Christian. You claim to be a man or woman of God. Then your time belongs to God. Your time belongs to God. No, not, oh, I need my alone time. I need my time. I need to get away. I need to know. Your time belongs to God. My time belongs to God. I surrendered that a long time ago. My time belongs to God. Sorry, I gotta be in church. Sorry. Sorry, I gotta be comforted. I gotta go, you know. So my time belongs to God. My time where does your time belong? What is, you know, your investments, your time and your money, show that. Where are they at? Do an examination. Where do all these things fall into? The second one is finances. Where does your money go? Do you spend a lot of your money on looking good and buying material things? Is image more important than spiritual things? You know, somebody here tonight, man. You're more into image and looking a certain way and keeping up a certain, you know, more into building your little kingdom and really investing your finances into the things that matter, the things that count, you know? And do you set aside your tithe before paying anything?
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
That's right.
Seriously. And I'm talking about before taxes. I'm talking about out of your gross pay. You set aside your... What? Jesus said it. Give to God what belongs to God and give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, right?
Yeah.
Do you set aside your time, you know, before paying anything? Come on. As a matter of fact, it's not even yours. Why are you holding on to it? It belongs to God and you're robbing God. So that's not even... You know, sometimes we get an idea, it's all right, I don't have to pay my tithe. You're holding on to something that doesn't belong to you.
Yeah.
Come on. You know? Aside from your tithe, do you give an offering? See, the tithe, let's just settle it here. The tithe is mandatory. It belongs to God.
Yeah.
Okay, everybody here tonight, we should be tithing.
Right.
That belongs to God. If you're not, then you're under a curse. That's what the Bible says. I believe the Bible. You're under a curse. You're stopping the windows of heaven from God. From God blessing your life. You know, the tithe is mandatory. The tithe belongs to God. Okay, so on top of that, you give an offering. You know, I'm challenging that area this year. I want to start giving more. I want to start giving on top of my tithe.
Yeah.
You know, and that's, you see, Malachi 3:8 says, will a man rob or defraud God? Yet you rob and defraud me. But you say, in what way do we rob and defraud you? You have withheld your tithes and offerings. See, when we hold back what belongs to God, we're robbing Him. And so we need to be givers of our finances. Where there's no giving, there's no return. When we give, we sow seed. How can we reap if we never sow? How can we reap if we never sow of our finances? How can we reap? What are we investing in? What are we investing in tonight? What are we investing in? Let's bow our heads tonight. Hallelujah. Why don't we stand to our feet? Just bow our heads. Hallelujah. I know we kind of left off on a serious note right there. But it's all right. The Word of God is truth. And the Word of God will deal with areas in our lives. And I don't know about you, man, but I want to build on blessings. I want to inherit what God has for my life, not because I want things, no, because I want to be obedient to God. And tonight we have an opportunity to check our hearts. Paul said, check your heart. Examine yourself. If there's sin in your heart, you need to examine yourself. We need to examine our hearts. In what areas are we holding back from what belongs to God? Whether it be in our obedience. We're not building on our obedience. If we're not building on our obedience, don't expect nothing. It's obedience that's the key to God's blessing. And also, like I was saying, when we build on our obedience, we inherit not only for ourselves, but for the ones after us. What are we holding back tonight? Are we not yielding to the Holy Spirit that allows us to and enables us to have self-control no matter how hard and no matter how much it hurts your flesh? Because I don't know about you, but whenever it's time for me to practice self-control, I can feel my flesh rising up against what God is trying to do. But that's where the test is. That's where the test is. That's where you gain your strength. You're strengthened when you're afflicted. You're multiplied when you're afflicted. And tonight, very quickly, we're gonna change the order of the service. And tonight, maybe you're here for the first time, and this message didn't apply to you. Well, it's okay. I believe that the Spirit of God is here, where the name of Jesus is lifted up, people draw all men to Him. And tonight we're here and we're lifting up the name of Jesus. And this message might have been for the church. God will deal with the church. But tonight, if you're here tonight and you don't know Jesus, and you feel a tugging in your heart, let me tell you something. That's the Holy Spirit. That's the Holy Spirit touching your heart right now. And believe me, you don't want to miss this opportunity. This is God calling you. This is your calling, the call to salvation. And if that's you, and you've never given your life to Jesus, or maybe you did give your life to Jesus, but you know that you're in sin and you're separated from God, you might be backslidden. You might be in a hard place right now. Let me tell you, don't pass up this opportunity. If you have sin in your life right now, then you need to repent and you need to recommit your life to Jesus. And if that's you, very quickly, as every head bowed and every eye is closed, if that's you, you want to give your life to Jesus, I want you to lift up your hand very quickly. Very quickly. Lift up your hand. Anybody. Don't miss this opportunity. This is what it's all about. This is what it's all about. We're not here to put on a show. We're here to preach the gospel. We're here to that God will lead people to repentance. And that's what it's all about, is filling up the filling up heaven. We want to fill up heaven. We want to fill up heaven with as many souls as we can before Jesus comes back. That's what we're called to do. And that's why we're here tonight. Anybody, you want to give your life to Jesus, lift up your hand very quickly. Anybody. You want to recommit your life, whether for the second time, it doesn't matter. You still got breath in your body. You still have an opportunity to give your life back to Jesus. Anybody. Hallelujah. Let's bow our heads. Hallelujah. Father, move by your Spirit. Touch your people, God. And if God spoke to your heart tonight. Oh, hallelujah. If God spoke to your heart as the worship team comes up. If God spoke to your heart tonight, we're going to open up the altar right now. And if God spoke to your heart on an area, whether it was obedience, self-control, or sowing seed, then come on up here tonight. God wants to do a miracle. But you have to come. There needs to be we need to yield to the Holy Spirit tonight. Come on.